Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته ومرحبا بكم جميعا في مكتبة الإسكندرية. بما أن هذا المؤتمر يستهدف في المقام الأول بناء جسور في مبادرات جديدة مع الزملاء من الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية، فسوف يكون جزء كبير إن لم يكن كل حديث بلغة الإنجليزية، ولكن هناك ترجمة فورية لمن يريد هنا في هذه القاعة، حتى ما فيش داعي إن حد يخرج بره، موجود هنا سماعات للترجمة الفورية. So most of the presentations are going to be in English and there is simultaneous interpretation and the earphones are here for those who want them. Secondly, please turn off your mobile phones. رجاء كده، رجاء خاص، إما أنك تتجرد من الموبايل أو أنك تقفل الموبايل حتى لا يدق في أثناء حديث المتحدثين. Ladies and gentlemen, over a year ago, the President of the United States, President Barack Obama, did something unprecedented. He came to Egypt at the invitation of Al-Azhar University and Cairo University and delivered an important speech in Cairo last June. It was a gesture with an outstretched hand that promised a new beginning. And although many of us have felt disappointed on some aspects of the pace of advance on long-standing political issues, we believe that there is no question that the President has created a new climate of collaboration and open doors between American institutions and the Arab and Muslim worlds. And so it came about that we tried to organize this conference here at the Library of Alexandria with the support and participation of a large number of institutions, as you can see, both from the United States and from Canada, as well as, of course, the OIC and the ISESCO and the Arab League and the Islamic Development Bank in Jeddah. All have given their support to this idea of looking for initiatives in education, science, and culture. And that is going to be the mandate with which we are going to address this conference. There will be other occasions in other fora where we can discuss what should and should not be done in Palestine, Iraq, Afghanistan, other of these well-known issues that still stand around. And we will focus in our deliberations on the constructive spirit of identifying ways of working together in education, science, and culture. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I just come from Washington, where I was at a meeting at the National Academy of Science with the Special Science Envoys and the State Department and the White House. And there is, I can assure you, a great deal of willingness to explore this, and especially the three envoys, Ahmed Zuhail, and Ilyas Zerhouni and Bruce Alberts, have done much to start this process of dialogue towards projects. But I have a special treat at this point. Although he is not with us in person, He is certainly with us in spirit. It is his spirit and his initiative that permeates our proceedings. And I believe that Mr. Hassan Rashad of the United States representative to the OIC has a message to deliver to the conference from President Barack Obama. Mr. Rashad.
Thank you so much. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I send greetings to those participating in Biblioteca Alexandrina's conference, Initiatives in Education, Science, and Culture Towards Enhanced United States Muslim Countries Collaborations. 1 year ago, I went to Cairo to call for a new beginning between the United States and Muslims around the world, one based on mutual interest and mutual respect. While we work together to address the security and political issues that have often been sources of tension, we must also seek new partnerships amongst our governments and peoples to address issues that matter most in our daily lives, to live with dignity, to get an education, to enjoy good health, to live in peace and security, and to give our children a better future. Let us create a world based on common principles we share: justice, progress, tolerance, and dignity for all mankind. I am encouraged by this conference and the diverse group of scholars, community leaders, students, and professionals gathered. As I said at the Presidential Summit on Entrepreneurship 2 months ago, the new beginning we seek is not only possible, it has already begun. We need a sustained effort to listen to each other, to learn from one another, to respect each other, and to seek common ground. I urge all participants to follow this paradigm as you explore the critical issues that will shape our collective future and build upon our new beginning. I wish you all the best for a productive conference. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Hassan Rashad. And now it is my great pleasure to introduce the Ambassador of the United States, Honorable Margaret Scobie. Please, the microphone is yours.
Good morning. And thank you, Dr. Siragadeen, for your introduction and for the invitation to participate in this conference, and most especially for having the vision to pull us all together a year after President Obama's speech to contemplate and to explore many of the ideas and themes that he introduced to us last year. It is always a very great pleasure to visit the Biblioteca, an institution that continuously pioneers new areas of research, community outreach, and international partnership. It's a particular honor to be part of such a distinguished group from around the world at this New Beginnings Conference. We're very happy to have His Excellency Dr. Ahmed Darwish as well, the Minister of State for Administrative Development. This is, I think, also demonstrates with the large number of distinguished visitors the efforts, broadly speaking, in Egypt and around the region to try to explore and to devise ways where we can work together more cooperatively. It demonstrates a strong personal dedication to achieving new beginnings in relations between the United States and Muslim-majority communities. I was very happy last year to join the 3,000 members of the audience at Cairo University last June when President Obama called for the new beginning between the United States and Muslims based on mutual interest and mutual respect. And as we just heard in President Obama's message today, we in the United States seek partnerships with both people and governments to address the issues that matter most in our daily lives. In Cairo last year, President Obama laid out a vision where we all embrace our responsibilities to build a world that is more peaceful and secure. He knew that this vision could not be fulfilled in a single year or perhaps several years. But today, as he outlined in his message again, we have come together in Alexandria to fulfill an important responsibility, to listen to each other, to respect one another, to seek common ground. And I thank you for joining us all to extend this new beginning that is already on its way. In Egypt and at the U.S. mission, we undertake the commitment to build a new beginning upon a solid foundation of partnership. For more than three decades, the United States and Egypt have shared the common goal of strengthening peace and mutual understanding in the region, and we have stood together through many challenges. Today, our work is focused on developing ways to build and to sustain a new beginning of Egyptian-American partnership. We are committed to broadening our engagement with the people of Egypt, and I think I can safely say that my colleagues and embassies in the region throughout the Muslim world are doing the same. We are partnering to promote education and to expand exchange programs and increase scholarships while encouraging more Americans to study in Muslim communities. We have increased the number of exchange opportunities for students and professionals in Egypt by over 52% in just the past year. We support partnerships between U.S. community college and institutions in order to share knowledge and to train students. We are expanding higher education scholarships, particularly for underserved secondary students to attend American-accredited universities in the region. We have a very well-established program at AUC that each year takes two young, successful students from each governorate in Egypt, a young man and a young woman, for a four-year scholarship at AUC in Cairo. The latest data show that these efforts are bearing fruit. We now have nearly 2,000 Egyptian students in the United States, and we are also using the Internet to bridge the geographic divide, bringing students in Cairo and California and Kansas together for collaborative research in architecture, design, and natural resources. And at the same time, the number of American students in Egypt was over 1,400, a 33% increase over the last year. So just as President Obama was calling on our partners and our friends in the Muslim community, he was also calling on Americans as well, and I think American students have very well heard his message. Egypt is the leading destination among all Arabic-speaking countries for Americans studying abroad. Alexandria itself has become a very elite Arabic language training destination with hundreds of American students attending courses here run by the University of Alexandria's program with Middlebury College, Georgetown University, and others. As we continue to develop even more exchange opportunities, we hope that more and more students from Alexandria and across Egypt will consider applying for these U.S. programs. We're also partnering with Egypt to promote economic growth and innovation. The President, as we heard, hosted a summit on entrepreneurship in April, and it brought together over 250 successful entrepreneurs from over 50 countries. They worked together to identify and to advance economic and social entrepreneurship, to build networks, to establish partnerships that will advance entrepreneurship and support each other's efforts. Egypt had the largest delegation to that summit, playing an important role in its follow-up. Egypt has been selected as the first country to take part in the Global Entrepreneurship Program, which will both support entrepreneurs through business plan competitions and expand their access to capital and to create partnerships between business schools in the United States and educational institutions in Egypt. And it will offer mentoring programs so that someone starting out can benefit from experience of others who have been down that road before. We will also establish in Egypt an entrepreneur in residence to be based in Cairo and to support the development and to increase U.S. and Egyptian partnership to support startups and entrepreneurs in Egypt. We're also very much looking to expand partnerships in science and technology. We've launched a Global Technology and Innovation Fund that will invest in technological development around the region, and our science envoys have been visiting countries to deepen science and technology cooperation. One of the best known, certainly, is Dr. Ahmed Zuhail, who I consider a perfect example of a successful U.S.-Egyptian partnership in science. He is a Nobel Prize winner and has never lost his interest in working with Egypt. The U.S. and Egypt have doubled our contributions to a joint science and technology fund, and we've announced that next year will be the U.S.-Egypt Science Year, in which we will host numerous programs and exchanges aimed at fostering new partnerships and greater cooperation in science and technology. And I'm honored that there are so many other distinguished Americans here. We're so happy to have Rashad Hussein, the President's Special Envoy to the Organization of the Islamic Conference, and Farah Pandith, the U.S. Special Representative to Muslim Communities. Just as we at the U.S. Embassy in Egypt are working to build stronger bonds here, these special representatives are also working around the world to deliver the President and the Secretary's message of engagement and cooperation, mutual interest, and mutual respect. None of our efforts to secure a better future will be easy. We realize that the new beginnings are but a long-term statement of commitment to these goals. We have begun. Now it falls to all of us, governments and individuals alike, to do the work to turn words into deeds and expanding the ties between us. Dr. Siragadeen, again, I thank you very much for the invitation and for your leadership in assembling this very distinguished conference, and I look forward to hearing from the participants and the results of this conference and its ideas for follow-on activities. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador Margaret Scobie, and we are very privileged to have a very distinguished guest with us whom I'm now inviting to the podium, and this is Farah Pandith, Secretary Hillary Clinton's Special Representative to Muslim Communities from the U.S. Department of State, Farah Pandith.
Assalamu alaikum, and good morning to everybody. We have a full crowd today. I heard that there are 45 countries represented at this conference today, and I feel really honored to be part of this. So thank you very much for that kind introduction. I wanted to spend a couple of minutes with you and talk about 1 year post-Cairo and the wonderful subject of education, science, and culture, and talk to you a bit about the President's vision for engagement. A vision that the ambassador spelled out based in Cairo last year, where he talked about a vision based on mutual interest and mutual respect. This effort to engage with Muslims around the world is unprecedented. We've heard this word before, but truly, in tone, in energy, in passion, in commitment, our government, in every single way, is engaging with Muslims around the world. The President, on his very first day, in his inauguration speech, talked about wanting to engage with Muslims. This is unprecedented. In Ankara and then in Cairo, he spelled out a vision in which he talked about different types of engagement and areas in which he thought we would partner and use our resources to build communities that were stronger for the common good. In the year past Cairo, we've seen many opportunities and some challenges. And we know, as the good doctor said as he started the speech, when you look at 12 months since the Cairo speech and you look at all of the things that we've talked about in that speech, we think about areas of engagement and we also think about things that we're working on. I want to talk to you a little bit about some of the challenges and the roads that we're taking ahead and some of the initiatives that we've put into action on the ground. Certainly, at no other time in history have we seen an increase in the passion and commitment of the U.S. government to engage around the world. And I see this not just from the Department of State, but I see it with all my colleagues in every part of government, whether you're the Department of Commerce, whether you're the Department of State, whether USAID, whether the U.S. Trade and Development Agency. We're using all of our engines to utilize and build community, partnership, engagement, dialogue. There are certain things that have happened over the course of the last year that you all know about. You know about the President's Summit on Entrepreneurship. you know about many of the deliverables, so to speak, that the President talked about. We also know that there are challenges that he has laid out, challenges that include issues in foreign policy in this part of the world, in the subcontinent, in other parts of the world as well. And we heard the President talk about his commitment to increase the way in which we're activating our mechanisms to work on these important challenges. And while we have not reached all of the goals yet, we are working hard toward that end. And that commitment and that passion and that dedication towards that goal has not stopped. As we think about the challenges and moving towards getting a resolution on many of these very difficult subjects, we see an increase in the way in which we're building capacity on the ground. We see a dedication to listen, to increase dialogue. At the Department of State, we are working with our embassies around the world. We think about the way the President has changed the lexicon in the way in which he's talking about engagement, his tone, his manner, his dedication to talking about the diversity of Islam around the world. I see all these flags on both sides of me, and I look out at an audience of 45 countries represented, and we all know the importance of the diversity of Islam. Whether you are a Muslim in Sao Paulo, or a Muslim in Stockholm, or a Muslim in Surabaya, you are a Muslim. And the President has asked us to increase our engagement both on a government-to-government level and on a people-to-people level. Special Envoy Rashad Hussein, who read the letter from the President, is committed to building bigger and stronger bonds, relationships, partnerships with the Organization of Islamic Conference. He's worked very hard on eradicating, working with the OIC to eradicate polio and maternal health. There are dozens of other initiatives that he's also working on. You hear the good doctor talk about my position at the Department of State, in which for the first time in American history, the Secretary of State has asked us to think about how we're engaging on a people-to-people level. For too long, we have only engaged on a bilateral relationship. What we've done is we've flipped the triangle on its head, and we've had a chance to think about what's happening on the grassroots level, to understand and organize ourselves so that we are listening on a community-to-community baseline. What is happening in Madrid is not what's happening in Barcelona. Certainly what's happening in Cairo is not what's happening in Alexandria. As embassies work on the ground on a people-to-people level, we're increasing the capacity for us to go deep and go wide, getting to know a wide view of what's happening at the grassroots and to listen to what's taking place. In my job, I'm working with embassies around the world to focus on ways in which we can activate the ideas that we hear on the ground, to use the American government as the convener, the facilitator, and the intellectual partner with the ideas that we hear on the ground, to bring new people to the player, to the table, to see where we can increase our relationships with the private sector to help them activate some of the ideas that we hear. We're bringing foundations and other organizations to the table to see where they can increase their partnership. We're looking at the diaspora community in America to see where they can increase their relationships with the ideas that we hear on the ground. We're building networks with the Facebook generation so that an amazing idea that we hear in Nouakchott can be connected to an idea in Lahore, Pakistan, because this generation, the under 30 generation, is the percentage of Muslims in those demographics around the world are really high. And we as Americans want to build long-term partnerships with this demographic to understand over the long term how we can build strong bonds and listen to the dialogue that's taking place so that we can activate ideas that are taking place. Whether we are talking about initiatives that were spelled out at the Entrepreneurship Summit and all of the things that have happened post-Cairo that the President has outlined, you can go to www.whitehouse.gov, look at the Cairo speech where you will see a wide range of sample projects from different parts of the government on what we've done. Or whether you are thinking about the way in which we can activate your resources as partnerships, you can go to imagine-nation.org www.bibliotheca.org, and you can build that mentorship capacity with entrepreneurs around the world. What has happened is what the doctor said. The climate has changed for dialogue. This president has activated an engine around the world in which people are thinking about ways in which they can add value to the issues of partnership and dialogue building. It is not just about the American presence doing this. It's about how we can think about the relationships we have with countries around the world and people around the world. As we build these networks, as we think about initiatives that will help for the common good, as we think about the way in which the tone and the tenor and the shape of conversation has taken place, as we think about what the president said about mutual interest and mutual respect, it means that in order to do that mutual side, we must listen to the other side. And we are trying as hard as we can to build the faculties available to us so that we can energize that kind of movement. What I have seen take place in the last year has been a solid commitment to reach a wide change in a narrative, to change the way in which we think about relationship building, to think about the long term, to activate young people to think about what we can do to help them build a stronger world. We've seen us work very hard simultaneously on a wide range of challenges that exist on the foreign policy side. Both simultaneously as we move this forward, we're seeing a way in which we can actually build stronger bridges. And that change is going to happen over the long term, but it is happening because people like you in this room and others in other parts of the world have taken it upon themselves to think about ways in which we can listen and distill the innovation and the ideas that are coming from incredible people like yourselves around the world. I ran into two people as I walked into this room today, both of whom are going to be on panels, and I'm not going to embarrass them by singling them out. But in their own shape, they have taken what they're passionate about and have understood how to activate their passion for change. And that is what I've seen in my job in the last year. 22 countries I visited since last October, and I've spoken to thousands and thousands of young Muslims from around the world. And I will tell you this, I am optimistic about this generation. I am eager to listen again and again and again to what they have to say, and it is incumbent upon us to do all that we can to activate this generation, to listen to their ideas, and see where we can all be that facilitator for change to build things for the common good. We have a lot of mutual things that we want to work on together, whether they're science and technology through a wide range of things, whether it's education, whether it's culture, whether it's art, or whether it's sports. We are seeing this on the ground, and I really look forward to finding out from you over the course of the next few days other ideas that you think that we can actually move forward. I want to thank you so much for the time that you've given us today to begin this conference, sir. And I want to thank all of you for being so supportive of this wonderful conference, because I know that as we were building the capacity and the momentum for this, it was your energy that was moving it forward. So congratulations for this wonderful event, and thank you for your time this morning.
Thank you very much for this very impassioned and wonderful opening speech. Ladies and gentlemen, we have many partners in organizing this conference, but three in particular stand out, and the leaders have sent representatives. And my next guest to the podium is Mr. Hisham Youssef, the special representative of Secretary General Amr Moussa of the Arab League. Dr. Hisham Youssef, please.
Dr. Ismail Siraj-ed-Din, Minister Ahmed Darwish, Governor Adel Labib, Ambassador Scobee, ladies and gentlemen, it's always a pleasure to be back in the Library of Alexandria, a beacon of hope in what sometimes seems like a rather bleak picture. It's an equal pleasure to be here to discuss an important issue that will have a profound impact on the future of both our region as well as the rest of the Islamic world. I think that we will all agree that the election of President Obama was greeted with enthusiasm that was unprecedented in modern history. It was greeted with enthusiasm by millions, perhaps even billions, from the four corners of the world. New heights of respect and admiration were reached for President Obama after he made his historic speech in Cairo, especially in this part of the world. There was an overwhelming feeling that President Obama is genuine, that he wants to achieve an objective that is shared by tens of millions in the Muslim world, namely, to turn a new page in the relations between the U.S. and the Muslim world. Many of us felt that this was a welcome change from the approach and attitude that was followed by the previous administration, that advocated that reform in our region should proceed, but on a premise that we did not share, because the premise was that change should come to this region because it is a threat to the West, not because it is demanded by millions in this part of the world. And in our view, this was supposed to be the premise of any approach for change or reform in this part of the world. We studied the speech of President Obama very carefully. It is indeed a historic speech. And a few weeks after the speech was delivered, we requested a dialogue with our colleagues in the United States to present a number of ideas on future cooperation between the U.S. and the Arab world. We suggested that we set political issues aside. Why? Because they were addressed in other tracks and they were subject to a host of other influences and developments. We presented ideas for cooperation with the U.S. on a host of issues, from programs for illiteracy for women, from programs for information technology and moving towards a knowledge society in our region, to activities on job creations in small and medium enterprises, from offering to work with the U.S. on the preparation for the Entrepreneurship Summit, to cooperation on the Technology Fund that was suggested by President Obama, to cooperation on health care, addressing environmental degradation, and also to address misconceptions, both in the Arab world and in the U.S., about each other. Our ideas were welcomed by the U.S., by our colleagues. However, unfortunately, and Ambassador Scooby is here, and despite our repeated inquiries, we haven't received any response to all these suggestions since then and until today. So this is a view from a number of circles in this part of the world. When the Entrepreneurship Summit was to be convened, and we learned about it from the press, we asked for information about this summit and how we can help. We were told that governments are not involved. We firmly believe that President Obama was genuine and sincere. And I listened today to a number of speeches where it was mentioned that enthusiasm is on the rise in many departments in the U.S. administration. I have to be frank and candid. We have not felt this enthusiasm in many of our circles in this part of the world. But there are still some successes. And I have to admit that we have tried and we implemented a number of projects. One of them was a very successful project with the Kennedy Center in Washington, where we had an Arab cultural festival, including activities from the 22 countries in the Arab world. A children's choir from Syria, a dancing company from Lebanon, Opera Aida from Egypt, a museum that was welcomed with great enthusiasm for wedding dresses from the Arab world, and much, much more. These are the kinds of projects and activities that we were hoping to be able to achieve. Our vision has proven to be crucial to the vital interests of the United States, from Iraq to Darfur and Juba, and from Afghanistan to Gaza and Jerusalem. I personally believe that without a structured, strategic dialogue between the United States and both the Arab and Islamic world, we will not be able to turn a new page in the relations between the U.S. and the Muslim world, according to what President Obama was aiming to achieve. Of course, this dialogue should not be limited to cooperation with governments. Absolutely not. On the contrary, it has to include cooperation with civil society, business communities, intellectuals, the media, and more. The theme of this conference, in and of itself, is a message. 1 year after the Cairo speech, we're talking about new beginnings. I sincerely hope that next year we would be meeting to talk about evaluating progress and future plans for advanced cooperation. Otherwise, we would be failing our people to the detriment of future generations. Thank you.
Thank you, Hisham. Our next
speaker, I'm not sure whether he has arrived. He was on his way, and he is the special representative of Dr. Muhammad Ahmad Ali, head of the Islamic Development Bank. But he was delayed, and I'm talking about Mr. Awad Salim. So I'm not sure he has arrived. I guess he is still delayed in arriving, but I can therefore, on behalf of Dr. Ahmad Ali, who sent me a very nice letter, bring you his greetings and his support to this conference. And I now will ask the next speaker, who is the representative of our foremost partner in this conference, which is ISESCO, and that is, of course, the Islamic organization dealing with education, science, and culture, whose Director General Dr. Abdulaziz Tuigri sent his special representative, Mr. Mohammed bin Saleh. Please welcome Mohammed bin Saleh of ISESCO.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم. أتيتكم من الرباط عاصمة المملكة المغربية محملا بتحياتي معالي الدكتور عبد العزيز بن عثمان تويجري المدير العام لإيسيسكو إليكم، وتمنياته لكم بالتوفيق والنجاح في أعمال هذا المؤتمر المهم لتحقيق الأهداف المتوخاة من عقده. كان مقررا أن يكون معالي الدكتور تويجري بيننا، لكن الالتزامات الطارئة حالت دون ذلك، ومع ذلك فهو معنا بدعمه لهذا المؤتمر، بدعمه لهذه الجهود الطيبة، وبكلمته التي كلفني بأن ألقيها على كريم مسامعكم. الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا رسول الله وعلى إخوانه رسل الله وعلى آله وصحبه، أصحاب المعالي والسعادة، حضرات السادة والسيدات، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. يسعدني أن أتحدث إليكم في الجلسة الافتتاحية للمؤتمر الدولي حول مبادرات في التعليم والعلوم والثقافة لتنمية التعاون بين أمريكا والدول الإسلامية المنعقد في الإسكندرية عروس المتوسط، ملتقى الحضارات وأرض اللقاء والحوار والمحبة والسلام. ويسعدني أيضا أن أستهل كلمتي بإسجاء الشكر والتقدير إلى سعادة الدكتور إسماعيل سراج الدين مدير مكتبة الإسكندرية، وإلى الجهات المتعاونة على مبادرتها إلى تنظيم هذا المؤتمر المهم الذي يعقد بدعم من الإيسيسكو، إدراكا منها لأهمية التربية والعلوم والثقافة في مد جسور التواصل والتعارف بين الأمم والثقافات، وفي تعزيز الفهم والتفاهم بين الشعوب والحضارات. أصحاب المعالي والسعادة، حضرات السادة والسيدات، ينعقد هذا المؤتمر في وقت تتزايد فيه الحاجة إلى تعزيز التعاون الدولي في مجالات التربية والعلوم والثقافة وتطويره وفق رؤية متبصرة واعية بدور هذه القطاعات الحيوية في إرساء دعائم الشراكة الدولية وتعزيز السلم العالمي. وذلك جزء من المسؤولية التي تنهض بها المنظمة الإسلامية للتربية والعلوم والثقافة إيسيسكو في إطار الاختصاصات المخولة لها من الدول الأعضاء، تقديرا منها لجهود الإيسيسكو في أداء رسالتها الحضارية الإنسانية ولدورها في الإسهام في تقوية أواصر التعاون في هذه المجالات بما يحقق التنمية والرفاه لدول العالم الإسلامي ويضيق الهوة بينها وبين البلدان المتقدمة في مجالات التقدم العلمي والتطور التقني، ويصحح الصور النمطية الخاطئة المتبادلة بين الشعوب، ويفتح آفاقا كونية رحبة من التعاون والتضامن مبنية على قواعد راسخة كفيلة بتحقيق تحالف فعلي بين الحضارات وتعزيز المشترك الإنساني. وما من شك في أن اختيار هذا المؤتمر لدور التعليم والعلوم والثقافة في تعزيز التعاون بين أمريكا والعالم الإسلامي يفصح عن رؤية متبصرة تسعى إلى معالجة الإشكالات القائمة في العلاقات الأمريكية الإسلامية من خلال التربية والعلوم والثقافة، وإثارة الاهتمام بدور هذه المجالات في تغيير الصور النمطية السلبية التي يحملها كل طرف عن الآخر، ومنها تلك الصور السائدة لدى كثير من صانع السياسة الأمريكية الخارجية بسبب مقولات الاستشراق ودعاية مجموعات الضغط وتأثير الآلة الإعلامية، والتي يتطلب تغييرها تزويد محترف السياسة الخارجية الأمريكية بمعلومات حقيقية حول القيم والمبادئ الإسلامية السامية والتاريخ المجيد للحضارة الإسلامية وإسهامها المتميز في مسيرة الحضارة الإنسانية، والرؤية الإسلامية للعلاقات مع غير المسلمين القائمة على أسس المساواة والتعايش والتسامح والاحترام المتبادل والتعارف والتآلف والتحالف، والتي تعبر عنها الآية الكريمة: يا أيها الناس إنا خلقناكم من ذكر وأنثى وجعلناكم شعوبا وقبائل لتعارفوا. وهي آية قرآنية تدعو إلى التعارف بين الشعوب والحضارات في إطار الأخوة الإنسانية التي تجمع بين الناس على اختلاف أديانهم وأجناسهم وأعراقهم، وهي قيم إسلامية إنسانية تسعى بعض الجهات المغرضة إلى التعتيم عليها لتشويه صورة الإسلام والمسلمين، وهو ما تسعى الإسيسكو إلى مواجهته من خلال الأنشطة والبرامج التي تنفذها في مجال الحوار بين الثقافات والتحالف بين الحضارات، والتي لم تقتصر على الندوات والمؤتمرات الدولية، وإنما شملت أيضا تعزيز التبادل المعرفي والثقافي مع عدد من مراكز البحث الجامعية والمؤسسات والمكتبات الأمريكية، وتزويدها بمجموعات مختارة من الكتب والمراجع التي تعرف بحقيقة القيم والثقافة والحضارة الإسلامية. أصحاب المعالي والسعادة، حضرات السادة والسيدات، لقد مثل الخطاب المهم الذي وجهه الرئيس باراك أوباما من القاهرة إلى العالم الإسلامي في مثل هذا الشهر من العام الماضي نقلة نوعية في النظرة الأمريكية الرسمية إلى الإسلام والمسلمين، وكشف النقاب عن توجه جديد في السياسة الأمريكية يعطي الأولوية في العلاقات الأمريكية الإسلامية لتسوية القضايا الخلافية في إطار مبادئ الاحترام المتبادل ورعاية المصالح المشتركة وقواعد القانون الدولي وقرارات الشرعية الدولية، وهو توجه كفيل بتحسين صورة الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية واستعادة ثقة العالم الإسلامي بعد عقود من الاحتقان والاحتجاج وأحياناً من الريبة والتوجس تجاه السياسة الأمريكية في العالم الإسلامي. لقد رسم خطاب السيد أوباما ملامح السلوك السياسي الأمريكي الجديد تجاه العالم الإسلامي، واستبشرت معه الشعوب والنخب الإسلامية بما قد تحمله وعود التغيير من رؤى جديدة لمعالجة القضايا الإشكالية في العلاقات الإسلامية الأمريكية، متمنية أن يتبع تغير الخطاب تغير السياسات حتى تتميز المقارنة بين السياسة الخارجية للإدارتين السابقة والحالية، وبخاصة سياسة أمريكا الشرق أوسطية، وفي القلب منها الموقف الأمريكي من الصراع العربي الإسرائيلي ومن المعاناة الفلسطينية المستمرة جراء ممارسات سلطات الاحتلال الإسرائيلي التي ما كان لها أن تكون بالهمجية والعنصرية التي هي عليه لولا يقينها بالحصول دوما على الدعم الأمريكي الذي يجعلها تعتقد أنها فوق القانون وفي حل من المساءلة والمحاسبة. وهو ما دفعني، يقول معالي المدير العام، إلى توجيه رسالة مفتوحة إلى الرئيس أوباما يوم 27 أبريل الماضي، قلت له فيها: سيادة الرئيس، لا يخامرني أدنى شك في صدق توجهكم لإقامة سلام عادل في الشرق الأوسط يتم بموجبه إعطاء الفلسطينيين حقهم في إقامة دولة مستقلة عاصمتها القدس الشرقية، وإنهاء معاناتهم التي طال أمدها، وتأتي مبادرتكم التي أعلنتم عنها بهذا الشأن والخطوات التي تم اتخاذها حتى الآن دليلا على ذلك، غير أن التعنت الإسرائيلي والاستمرار في بناء المستوطنات في القدس الشرقية وباقي أنحاء الضفة الغربية والتهديد بشن هجمات على سوريا ولبنان وإيران والتمادي في عملية تهويد القدس وإجراء الحفريات تحت المسجد الأقصى في مخالفة للقانون الدولي وتعال على إرادة المجتمع الدولي المصممة على إنهاء هذه المشكلة، كل ذلك يعد تحديا لمبادرتك ورفضا لها. وأضفت: إن مصالح الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية في العالم الإسلامي كبيرة وكثيرة، وليس من المنطق ولا من الحكمة ولا من المصلحة إهدارها لإرضاء مجموعة من المتطرفين في إسرائيل لا ترغب في السلام ولا تسعى لتحقيقه وتعمل في إصرار على عرقلة جهود السلام بشتى الوسائل. ولقد أبدى العالم الإسلامي حرصه على حل هذه المشكلة المزمنة، فتبنى خطة السلام العربية التي رفضتها إسرائيل وماطلت في تحقيق أي تقدم يضمن تنفيذها، بل إن إسرائيل تقوم اليوم بتأليب القوى اليهودية المؤثرة في الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية وفي العالم لمناهضة سياستكم، وتستنجد بشخصيات يهودية تدعي حرصها على السلام أمثال ويلي فيزل للضغط عليكم من خلال وسائل الإعلام التي تتحكم فيها وتقديم الصورة مغلوطة للرأي العام الأمريكي والعالمي بصورة عامة عن حقيقة الموقف الإسرائيلي المتعنت. لذلك فإنني وبصفتي مواطنا عربيا مسلما منشغلا بقضايا الحوار بين الثقافات والتحالف بين الحضارات وبثقافة العدل والسلام والتعايش بين الشعوب، أدعوكم لكي تستمروا سيادة الرئيس في مساعيكم لتحقيق هذا الحلم النبيل، حيث سيكتب لكم التاريخ إذا نجحتم في مسعاكم وحرصتم على تطبيق سياستكم المعلنة في الشرق الأوسط أنكم صانع العدل والسلام في الأراضي المقدسة، وهذا فخر لكم وللشعب الأمريكي لا يماثله فخر في دنيا السياسة. انتهت الرسالة. ولقد سبق لي أن عبرت عن هذه المواقف خلال الزيارة الرسمية التي قمت بها إلى الولايات المتحدة في شهر مارس الماضي بدعوة رسمية من وزارة الخارجية، التقيت خلالها بعدد من المسؤولين السامين المعنيين بالعلاقات بين أمريكا والعالم الإسلامي. أصحاب المعالي والسعادة، حضرات السادة والسيدات، إن تحسين صورة الولايات المتحدة في العالم الإسلامي لا يتأتى بحملة علاقات عامة
وإنما بتغيير سياساتها تجاه قضايا العالم الإسلامي وفي مقدمتها القضية الفلسطينية. وإننا إذ نعي صعوبة تحقيق هذا التغيير في ضوء التحليل البنيوي لصياغة السياسة الأمريكية الخارجية، فإننا لا نشكك في صدق نوايا الرئيس باراك أوباما تجاه العالم الإسلامي، ولا نشك في احترامه للإسلام والقيم الإسلامية وللمبادئ السامية الواردة في وثيقة الاستقلال الأمريكي، والتي جعلت الشعوب الإسلامية تنظر إليها على أنها بلاد الأحرار وموطن الشجعان، قبل أن ترث عن بريطانيا مشروع التمكين للمشروع الصهيوني في فلسطين منذ تمريرها لقرار التقسيم عام 47 و900 و1000، ودعمها للحرب على العرب والفلسطينيين عام 48 و900 و1000، ومسارعتها إلى الاعتراف بإسرائيل بمجرد إعلان نشوئها. وهو ما يعني أن المواقف والسياسات الأمريكية المتعلقة بفلسطين هي السبب الرئيس في الصورة السلبية للولايات المتحدة الأمريكية لدى قطاعات واسعة من النخب والشعوب الإسلامية. وكلنا أمل في أن تعمل الإدارة الحالية على تغيير هذه الصورة بتغيير تلك المواقف والسياسات. وقد قلت للرئيس أوباما في رسالة وجهتها إليه بحكم الموقع الذي أشغله في إطار العمل الإسلامي المشترك، نحن في المنظمة الإسلامية للتربية والعلوم والثقافة إيسيسكو، التي تضم في عضويتها 50 دولة من دول العالم الإسلامي، والتي لها علاقات تعاون مثمر مع عشرات المنظمات والهيئات الدولية والإقليمية، ننظر إلى سيادتكم بعين التفاؤل، وندعو لكم بالنجاح في مهامكم السامية لمعالجة المشاكل المزمنة والتحديات العاتية التي يعاني منها العالم اليوم، وفي مقدمتها الحروب والعدوان على حقوق الشعوب وكرامتها، والركود الاقتصادي والفقر وغيرها من المشاكل والتحديات التي تحتاج إلى عمل دولي مشترك ومستمر يساهم في التصدي لها. أصحاب المعالي والسعادة، حضرات السادة والسيدات، إن المحاور التي سيتم بحثها في أعمال هذا المؤتمر تتناول قضايا حيوية في العلاقات الإسلامية الأمريكية، ولا شك أن الأزمات المتعددة التي يتخبط فيها عالم اليوم تنذر بانعكاسات سلبية على مستقبل المجتمعات الإنسانية، وتستدعي تعزيز التعاون الدولي من أجل معالجتها، بما في ذلك التعاون بين الولايات المتحدة ودول العالم الإسلامي. فالعالم الإسلامي يدرك وهو يسعى إلى تحسين علاقاته مع الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية أنها من أكثر القوى الدولية ارتباطاً بقضاياه السياسية والاقتصادية والثقافية وتأثيراً فيها، وقدرةً على تحقيق الاستقرار الإقليمي والحفاظ على توازن المصالح في النظام الدولي، مثلما تدرك الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية أن العالم الإسلامي هو أحد الفضاءات الجيوسياسية الأكثر أهمية وحيوية للمصالح الاستراتيجية للولايات المتحدة الأمريكية، لاعتبارات اقتصادية وسياسية وتاريخية والجيوستراتيجية، وهو ما يفسر حاجة كل طرف إلى الآخر، ويفرض التعامل مع مستقبل التعاون بينهما بتفكير استراتيجي استشرافي ذي بعد إنساني يقوم على خدمة المصالح المشتركة في إطار الاحترام المتبادل، مثلما يقوم على بناء الإنسان في أمريكا والعالم الإسلامي تربوياً وعلمياً وثقافياً بناءً متوازناً ينمي شخصيته على الاعتزاز بقيمه الدينية وذاته الثقافية وهويته الحضارية، ويقوي انتماءه إلى الحضارة الإنسانية والقيم الكونية التي تعد قاسماً مشتركاً بين القيم الأمريكية والمنظومة القيمية الإسلامية، ويزرع فيه بذور العمل من أجل التنمية والرخاء والاستقرار والسلام والازدهار. وفي الختام أرجو أن نوفق في إرساء علاقات مبنية على الاحترام المتبادل والعدل والإنصاف، خدمة لمصالحنا المشتركة وخدمة للإنسانية جمعاء. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته.
Thank you very much, our colleagues from CESCO, for this marvelous speech by Dr. Abdelaziz Touejri, who is with us through his representative and with us through his support for this conference, for which we are most grateful. And now it is my great privilege to introduce, on behalf of the Egyptian government, Dr. Ahmed Darwish, Egyptian Minister of State for Administrative Development. Dr. Ahmed Darwish.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم. May peace be on you. Not sure how this 1400-year-old greetings that depicts one of the core values of Islam. Not sure how in the last few years an image was slowly painted that it is just a greetings. And since then, plenty of misunderstanding, misinterpretations started to appear on the scene. Anyway, I have two comments before I start. First comment is that Dr. Ismail has hinted to it that I'll be delivering my speech in English. This is to show that we are truly would like to bridge the gap and to extend the hand. We Egyptians and Arab in general, we are known to, one of our values is to be generous with our guests. And this is our gesture to our guests. The second comment is that I've been a university professor, if you looked at my CV, so I'm not very disciplined. I'm used to lecturing. I'm not used to reading from a written speech. My staff always warned me that a politician must carefully select his words. And my reply is usually, if it comes from the heart, it is genuine and you can never go wrong. So let's see how disciplined I am reading this speech that I have written last night. I will try to tackle things from a different angle, from a different view. So bear with me. I know we are already 15 minutes beyond the schedule that is published. So my speech is in the extra time or the substitute time if you are following what's going on in sports right now. But anyway, let me give you a little bit of history or something that happened personally to me some time ago. A US-based, well-known, respectable TV station approached me and said that they will be doing a documentary or a miniseries on Islam versus the West. And they would like to invite me to an interview. The first question that came to my mind, Islam is a religion and West is a geographic direction. They told me when I was a school kid that the opposite of West is East. And Islam is a religion, thus it has no opposite. Though I was unable to understand the notion, but at least it seemed to me that they were not the opposite of each other. Thus, we can start working out something if these two are not the opposite. Hopefully, to erase the concept in the first place. I don't really want to undermine the idea of the conference, nor all these great efforts on dialogue between religions. But my own opinion is, if we get the religion parameter out of the formula, we will have a better understanding, and we will advance much more faster on the road to smoother relations. I have plenty of evidence that scratches out religion from the formula. This is not the topic of today, but just some food for thought. It seems to me that the source of all religions is the same. I'm not aware of a religion that endorses lying or stealing, for example. Thus, the question does not lie in the core values, because more or less they are all the same. It lies in how you practice. I will even go further. It's not in practicing. It's unfortunately in the manipulated interpretation of these practices. So I really like the idea about using this term West, or use the term United States, because it opens the way for the second term to become, for example, the Middle East. At least this way, we are matching homogeneous concepts. This immediately will make sense, because a new parameter will come into the formula, which is culture. And that, I claim, is much stronger than religion. And I need not give evidence on that, because the same religion is practiced in countries of wide cultural varieties. This is why I was optimistic when Dr. Ali Samman has changed the organization that he promotes from interfaith dialogue to intercultural and interfaith dialogue. I quote him, "Cultural understanding, which includes knowledge of history and values of people, can provide enormous support to understanding the way they practice religion." There is plenty of evidence on that. Among them, of course, is the most evident example on the difference between the role and the right of women in Islam and the cultural heritage of that in some Muslim countries. We are gathered here as a part of a larger initiative to capitalize on President Obama's speech last year at Cairo University. A new beginning, a true big step forward. He stressed what I believe is an opportunity to reap the benefits of cooperation between our nations, our people, and our cultures. Those were not empty words or eloquent speech to be heard and forgotten. This is an extended hand, and it's time for action on both sides. We could start with some classic ideas that have been mentioned. For example, why is the U.S.-Middle East relationship important? We could mention the size of the population. Economically, this is a market opportunity, the geopolitical significance, the protracted political conflict, immigrant form, a major minority, emerging unfavorable feelings towards U.S. Let me assure you that it's bilateral. Not only is the U.S. important for the Middle East, but the opposite is also true. Now, when we are discussing a new beginning, there are two schools. Some people would say, let's start fresh on a white piece of paper. Others will say, can we understand what has harmed this relationship to learn something and rectify it? I'm not going through what has harmed this relationship because plenty have been talked. The least about it is the Arab-Israeli conflict, the limitations imposed on economic opportunities, the misunderstanding, mistrust. The list is long. But I want to move forward. As I have mentioned, I've been privileged to experience the firsthand the wonderful process of education, the opening of minds of our youth, the exchange of ideas and thoughts that ensues. One of the great things about us humans is our ability to view things in different ways and to reach different solutions to the same problems. It is very important to enrich the relationship between U.S. and Middle East through adopting untraditional ways. I'm for that. First of all, science and technology. Science and technology are excellent ways to encourage teamwork by bringing together cosmopolitan scientists and specialists. Science and technology are common language for youth and those who have the responsibility to train them. Science and technology are also the language for the future, and those who will miss out the train will be left behind. That's a huge price to pay. Science and technology are the basis for the creation of a development process. That was first. Second, Art, music, cinema represent a great communication language and an untraditional method of intellectual exposure between East and West. Please fetch in the back of your mind, talking to Egyptians and Arab or in the hall, and see if images engraved about American society is somehow based on American movies. Let us not also underestimate the power of sharing, the listening of enjoyment. Immediately here pops up concerts and exchanging them. Do I have to go through them on a one-by-one basis? Here is another. International sculpture parks, international paintings exhibitions play a vital role in conveying intellectual messages that enable people to explore talents of other countries. Thank you, Hisham, for mentioning the importance of what has happening regarding this cultural event that was in the United States. I'm a believer of that. By the way, I'm only concentrating on concepts, not tools, because we're expecting tools to be delivered. That is to say, I mentioned science and technology, but I left it to experts to decide on the best scholarship program, to decide on establishing awards for conducting cooperative research, to establish mechanisms for university partnerships. I mentioned movies, and I left it to both sides to practice the role of cultural centers, libraries, newsletters. It's up to you to come up with the tools and the ideas, but let's work on them. My invitation is, please, explore new areas and means of untraditional communication that will bring about the warmth of closeness and accepts the colorfulness of differences. I know I've taken more than my time, but I cannot close out without highlighting a very important aspect that we must work on, primary education. Please don't underestimate the power of school books. Those are the first steps of kids in life, where they start compiling ideas and opinions. Normally, it's very hard to change or wipe them later on. This is a plea for educators and publishers of books on history, geography, culture, art, you name it. A plea for no generalization, no stereotyping, and more cross-disciplinary education that is able to separate between religious beliefs and cultural behavior of followers. Last but not least, I have two more parameters. Popular leaders and intellects on both sides, they share a responsibility in producing a real shift in U.S.-Middle East relations by working to dispel misconceptions and promoting tolerance. I wonder if you have realized the fact that this whole speech, if you take out Middle East and put Islam or Islam and Middle East, it still works. But I insist on using the geographic notion rather than the religion. Number two, unfortunately, we have been witnessing more of an academic approach in this past year, namely studies, conferences, workshops, where the elite are invited. I wish to see more involvement of responsible media. This is not going to happen, Mr. Ambassador Farah, this is not going to happen without allocating the budget. Media does not work for free, unfortunately. Let me close by saying that the first U.S. president visited Egypt in 1877, President Grant, and the last visited Egypt in 2009, President Obama. A lot has happened in between. To me, the most important was in 1922, where we have a mixture of politics and technology. 1922, where the year President Harding introduced the first radio into the White House. He also was among the first to support and congratulate Egypt on its independence from Great Britain and welcome Egypt into, quote unquote, the family of free nations. This comes natural. The United States was founded on a great value of the freedom of diversity. Let's keep it that way. And let us make sure that this spirit is accepted among nations, not only within nations. Farah, I'm not any less optimistic than you. I'm probably more optimistic. I wish you a very successful and fruitful conference, and I do look forward to your recommendations. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.